Hi, this is Julie Harland, and I'm your math gal. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where you could search for any of my videos organized by topic.
Right, this is an introduction to sets. A set is simply a collection, right? Or you could say it's a collection of objects. For instance, a set could be a set of stamps you've collected. Or let's say you're doing some math, it might be some numbers. Those really don't look like objects, but it's just any collection you have at all. Now, the notation we use for set is by using braces. In math, one way to denote a set is by using braces. The objects in the set are called elements, and we separate the elements with commas. So here is an example of a set. You have these braces. Okay, so it's not a parenthesis. And let's say I've got some numbers in my set. So let's say I have these numbers, 2, 5, 6, and 8. That's an example of a set. Okay? It's a collection of four numbers. Sometimes we like to call the set something so we don't have to write out the whole set. And usually we use a capital letter, but you don't have to. I'm going to call this set A. All right, so this is the set A, and this is what set A looks like. It's got the braces, four numbers with commas. Now, another notation that you sometimes use is helps you tell how many numbers are in a set. You put the number n and a parentheses, and then you write the set. So you could either write A, or you could actually write the whole thing out here with the braces and the numbers and the commas. I'm just going to put the number of elements in A. That n means the number of elements in A. For those of you who know function notation like f of x, that's not what this is. All right, so it's in the context of talking about this set A, the number of elements in A. So if you go over here and count them, there are four elements. Now, it doesn't matter the order that you write the numbers in. That's why we use braces, not parentheses. Parentheses, when you have an ordered pair, it matters. The first number is the x coordinate, the second number is the y coordinate. Here it doesn't matter. So I could have switched and put the 6 here and the 2 here. It makes no difference the order you write the numbers in, or whatever else happens to be in your set. Now, a lot of times what we want to do is sort of restrict the universe and what we're talking about to something in particular, and that's called the universal set. So let's call it, and it's like a script, capital U. Let's say the universal set are these numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Let's end it. That's it. Let's say that's the universe. We're not going to consider any numbers except 1 through 9. So A of these numbers has 2, 5, 6, and 8. Let's make another set from the universal set. So if I pick some other numbers, how about if I pick 3, 4, and 5? Okay, that's another set. All right, let's pick another set. How about 5, 8, and 9? These are all subsets. A, B, and C are called subsets of the universal set. Okay? So a subset is got either the same amount of elements or fewer elements than the bigger set. And the notation we use for subset looks like this. Okay? This little line under here means it could be equal. If you don't have this little line under here, it means it can't be exactly the same set. So in our example, A is a subset of the universal set. B is a subset of the universal set, and C is a subset of the universal set. And that's how it's always supposed to be. If you're going to pick some sets from the universal set, it has to be that any of the elements in A have to be in the universal set. Okay? So B, these elements are chosen from the universal set. I could also have a subset of A. All right? So if we look at A, let's pick a subset from there. How about 5 and 6? So we'll take the set 5 and 6, and I'm going to say that's a subset of A, okay? Because it's a set that has some of the elements that are in A. Now, what about this? What about if I have 3, 4, 5? Can I say that's a subset of B? Sure, because it contains elements, only elements that are in B. Okay, so it comes from the elements of B. And that's why this line is important. It means it could actually equal B as well. If you take that line off, what it's saying is it cannot be equal. So it could either be 3 or just the number 4, or just number 5, or 3 and 4, or 4 and 5, or 3 and 5, but not all the numbers. It can't exactly be equal. All right, let's take this same universal set here, and we've got three subsets of that, A, B, and C. All right, here's the notation. If you have this kind of long-looking C thing with an underline, it means is a subset of, and it means really it could be a proper subset or it can actually be equal. And without the equal sign, it means is a proper subset of, which means it has to have fewer elements than the original one. So let's decide if each of these statements I have down here are true or false. All right, the set 6, 8 is a subset of A. So what you have to do is say, as long as all the elements in here are also in A, and there's fewer elements, then it's going to be true. So what you're looking for to say it's false is a contradiction. Like if it had the number 1 in it, that would be a contradiction. So a 6 and 8, is that set a subset of A? Yes. So that's true. Next one. The set that has 3 and 6, is that a subset of B? So make sure that any elements in here are also in B. Well, 3's in, but 6 is not, so that's false. Five, eight, and nine. That set with 5, 8, and 9, is that a proper subset? I haven't been saying this. Is it a proper subset, right, of C? So you look. No, it's not, because it's actually equal to C, so this one is false. If it's exactly the same, to make it true, you would have to have that line under here. Okay? Without the line, it's false. All right, 3, 4, and 5, is that a subset of B? It's actually equal to B, so the answer is going to be true. I don't have room to write, I don't think, true. Here we go. How about the set with the number 9 in it? Is that a subset of C? Yes, because 9 is in there. And here's the trickiest one of all, the last one. What's in there? There are no numbers in there. So there can't be any contradiction. So actually, the set that has nothing in it, all right, nothing at all in it, so there's no elements, is going to be a subset. Doesn't matter what it is. It didn't matter if I put A, B, C, D, F, G, U, whatever it is, the answer is always going to be true. That's hard for people to understand, but this is called the empty set. The empty set is always a subset. So in other words, to make one of these statements false, you have to give an example of something in the set, right, that is not in the bigger set, okay, the set on the right-hand side. So, for instance, this second one here, where I have 3 and 6 is a subset of B, my contradiction is right here. I could tell them, hey, 6 is not in B, and that's the reason it's false. You have to have a reason like that. All right, so this set with no elements in it is called the empty set or null set. That's how we usually refer to it in math. And another way to write the null set, it looks like a zero with a line through it. So those of you who are used to writing a zero as a zero with a line through it, it's going to be confusing in math because we actually use that to represent the null set. So here's a tricky thing. Is that the null set? No, because here's the weird part. It's a set, and now I see there's something in it. I know the something in it's a null set, but that's something. So this is not the null set. It's either you write the braces with nothing in it, or you write that zero, if you want to think of it, or an O with that that diagonal line through it. There is a lot more to sets than this, and sets can be described in words. Sets can have infinitely many elements in it, etc. So here are just a couple more examples. I could say the set of US presidents who served in the 1900s, and then I would just list all the presidents from the 1900s. Well, that's a long list. I'm not going to do it right here, but you would, begin writing the first person's name and then put a comma in the next person's name, etc., until you listed them all. So that's one way of doing it. But at least there's only a certain number of presidents, right, that served in the 1900s. How about the set of even whole numbers? There's a problem here. It's impossible to list all of these, but there is a way of do showing what you mean. The first even whole number is actually the first even one is zero because I said a whole number. Zero is a whole number. Zero, two, four, and of course I can't list all of them. It's absolutely impossible because this goes on forever. So if something goes on forever, what you do is after one of the commas, you establish a pattern so people could kind of get the idea of what's going on, and then you put three dots. And this means and so on. This just keeps going on forever and ever. All right, so I'm not going to, discuss too much more because there's just a lot of different ways that you could describe sets, lots of different examples. But in math, mainly, we're going to probably use maybe we'll have a set with maybe some numbers or some letters in it usually. And so in the next video, I'm going to work with sets a little bit more. After you have a set, what can you do with them? What are some other symbols we use in set theory?
Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com where you can view all of my videos, which are organized by topic.